I am of the very strong persuasion that we Pacific people have something in the world that's completely different from all other people. That if you're gonna influence any society or any group of people, information is the key. That's the driver. It's a change of thinking, influence their thinking, which consequently influence their lifestyle, their behavior, and information is the key thing to that. And so that's why I hang on for dear life to media. The victory for freedom of the press and freedom of expression was a victory for the people.
For this godfather of the Pacific media, freedom of speech has been a constant struggle and come at a price. But he's opened the floodgates for many journalists in the Pacific today by being the first voice to dare to criticise the repressive Tongan regime in the mid-90s with his now famous publication, Daimi o Tonga.
Up to that time, there was a declaration from government that there was no one that could start a newspaper in Tonga, not a private person. The first issue, I couldn't go to sleep for almost 3 days. You know, you typed out the stories, you had to lay them all out in those early days without the digital, where you had to paste and wax them, and then they photographed them. And then took it to the printer and got it printed in a sheet-fed print press, you know, and you wait for half a day for it to finish. You collate it by hand, and then you go out and sell them to the stores. Within a three-month period, we had already bypassed both the church and the government newspaper in terms of volumes and demand, and very, very fulfilling experience.
Don't you know? But changing the system took its toll on this veteran champion of media freedom. In 1996, the Tongan government sentenced him to 30 days in maximum security prison for treason.
All of a sudden, we were jailed, and we are not prepared for it. Not only I was jailed, but my assistant editor was jailed. So that was the hard thing about it. So we had the whole operation there without any leaders. They put us in maximum security. We're not allowed pen, paper, anything to read, you know. But I mean, the guy who jailed us was kind of going out to get us, you know. But the funny thing, in maximum security, was they just had New Zealand aid and they put up new facilities. And so the three cells where we were at were the brand new facilities, had your own flush toilet and all of these other things, you know. It was just incredible. We were better than the other non-maximum security. But what was famous was my toilet paper letters. You know, that I took the toilet paper because we're not allowed pen and paper. And then one of the guards that came in and got me to sign. Every time somebody said in food, I had to sign it. And I just held on to the pen after the last signature. And so, yeah, I started writing my articles, the editorials, things on toilet paper, big, nice, thick American toilet paper, and wrapped them up. So whenever somebody came for a visit, I would hug them and put the toilet paper issued on their hands. And they took it back to the office and they just typing. That went on for 4 weeks almost, yeah? It came up in government, in parliament actually, because the Minister of Police got up and says, here they are, they're in jail, and he's still writing. A journalist that was going to come to try to get us out of maximum security. So I whispered, please don't. We're very comfortable at maximum security.
Those days behind him, Kalafi now focuses on the international distribution of the newspaper that's been his passion for so long. And also on his raft of books on subjects as varied as Tonga's history and turbulent social political situation.
We thought democracy was going to be the savior. It's going to be the messiah that will come and solve our problems. It's one thing to change your system to be a democracy. It's another thing to actually practice the principles of democracy. We still have a high crime rate. It's going on. Corruption has not changed. It's still there. Our health issues is still bad. Our economy is really down. So there are all of these things that we had been looking for democracy to fix, and it hasn't been able to fix it. It's people in that system. Once they get, they change and they become people who are honest and transparent and accountable and committed to good governance, we will get good results out of that.
Press freedom in the Pacific is a massive thing now, you know, compared to when it first started. It's definitely a motivation and, you know, encouragement for us young, you know, kids to try and continue what they've started.
I think he worked on opening up all sorts of interesting little nooks and crevices in Tongan society to make Tonga talk about freedom generally. So you could say that he rewrote a chapter in the development of media in Tonga. And as far as media freedom is concerned, he paid dearly for that because he lost his freedom. He lost a lot of his personal wealth, basically, as a consequence of what he's done.
He definitely has paved a way for us, I guess, younger ones, because he's sort of that older generation. He sort of stepped up and was prepared to put himself out there.
It's an exciting life. I wouldn't change it for anything, Lisa. And it gives my children and grandchildren now just a much different perspective about life. Anything that brings changes, good changes to people's lives, it's wonderful. It's worth sacrificing for.